course, the goal is not to make Node.js like disappear off the earth, but we decided to take another stab at like building a server-side JavaScript runtime.
You might want to check out Deno. This is a new piece of software. It's 1 month old.
I think we have pretty solid ideas about how we can do things better, but you know, you are up against technology that is everywhere, and like everybody knows about it. That's a challenge.
Yeah, it's like competing against your own past work.
I mean, I guess like if you have to compete about anything, that's like, it's probably like the best thing you can do. If you lose, you still win.
I was working on TensorFlow a bit and thinking about how models are represented in mostly in Python. And of course, you know, with my Node experience, I'm always thinking JavaScript is a dynamic language that more people know, that is faster, that, you know, I think would work for representing these neural network models. Can't we take TensorFlow and bind this to Node and make a machine learning framework from this? Maybe it should have an API that's more similar to PyTorch. Maybe it should have this autograd, automatic differentiation sort of functionality in it. Yeah, so started taking Node and TensorFlow and basically trying to mash those two things together. Worked on that with Bert, the guy who did the Windows port of Node for a good 6 months or so before TensorFlow.js came out.
We're very excited to announce TensorFlow.js.
And then we were like, actually TensorFlow.js is doing this pretty well. Maybe it doesn't make so much sense to compete with Google at machine learning frameworks. That experience of like combining TensorFlow and Node got us thinking about all of the problems with Node. You know, kind of the typical legacy system issues. I had this conference talk coming up where I was going to present our machine learning framework, and decided to scrap that and like throw together my demo of you know, how I would design Node differently if it was today.
Using Node is kind of like nails on chalkboard to me at times, just because I see the bugs that I introduced that aren't really bugs at this point, they're just how it works, but they are bugs, and they were design mistakes made that just cannot be corrected now because there's so much software that uses it. I don't know, it offends my sensibilities. It could have been much nicer.
And that ended up being kind of the prototype of Deno.
A prototype of how things might be differently, or how like Node might be differently if you designed it today.
Yeah, it was basically put together in just a couple of weeks for this conference.
We are trying to have a little bit of a different angle. So, you know, in Node.js, take web technologies, but run them on a server, on a Linux server in particular, and also on Windows and Mac, because, you know, the developers need to work somewhere. And with Deno, it's more like, okay, let's start with the assumption that you are going to build a web application or a backend, and you're going to deploy it on the cloud, but you don't want to deal with cloud, and then sort of look what's required there, and then bring that to the runtime. So yeah, it tries to take a different approach, or look at it, the problem differently.
It's written in Rust. It's you know, written 10 years later, so it's using a lot of the infrastructure that has been developed in the last 10 years to kind of build a better system.
Node was created back in, I believe, 2009, and there's been a lot of updates and improvements to the language since then. So Deno takes advantage of more modern JavaScript.
The technical problems that we had to solve like 10 years ago, they are solved now, and now we have to solve different technical problems. Back then we only did HTTP 1, and now there's HTTP 2 and 3, and like that needs to be implemented somehow. The web has many more features, and we try to have all those features also in our runtime, and so you just, there's like much more breadth to what you need to implement.
It's kind of a full toolkit for JavaScript development. Lessons that I learned from Node building Deno, I think a whole lot of things that are basically innumerable. Maybe like high level things is, you got to be really careful making choices because, you know, some choice that you make early on may end up kind of has these echo effects for many years later as you build on it.
It's a little bit tricky because we weren't too happy about the way Node modules and NPM packages ended up working. We saw a lot of problems with them. So we thought we'd make it much simpler and do it like in a very obvious way. And that has a kind of like problems of its own. So, you know, yeah, you also find that, yeah, there is maybe some merit to it. That's not so obvious, yeah. But yeah, it is nice to be able to start from scratch and then, yeah, like at least you can, like very obvious mistakes that you make, then you can avoid those. That also keeps it fun. It's not, I wouldn't do it if we were like literally building the same thing as 10 years ago. That just seems boring.
I'm developing Deno as a commercial product and am doing the startup route this time, which, you know, adds another constraint to the development of this, which is that like ultimately it needs to generate revenue.
Deno deploy is kind of the other half of Deno, right? Deno is a open sourced, MIT licensed, very much like Node thing that runs on your terminal. Deno deploy is uses a lot of that technology, runs in the cloud, runs in 35 data centers worldwide, and is a serverless edge functions platform.
I also think that's a healthy thing to have for a software project because it's really a fallacy to think that like open source software is developed for free. It's not developed for free. It's developed at the expense of somebody. Maybe it's somebody putting in their free time to develop it. Maybe it's Google sponsoring a project, right? But I mean, software engineers are expensive and, you know, need to be paid at the end of the day. And so thinking about kind of the revenue sources and how you can manage a, you know, software at scale, I think is really an important part of building great software.
In March of 2021, the Deno company was announced. So this is nice because having a company backing a project can really help because you can lay out a roadmap, you can allocate workers to work on specific things, and just generally have better control of how the project is going to be developed. On the other hand, Node.js is run by almost all volunteers. So, you know, we can't really, on the Node side, control who is going to work on what. We can't tell volunteers to spend their time on certain features. And we've even had initiatives like Node's benchmarking working group, which is doing a lot of useful work, have to be wound down because there just was nobody that was working on them at the time. So having a company backing the project is huge, in my opinion.
In particular, I don't want to end up in a place where I was in 2011, where I've got a very popular software project that is solving a lot of problems for people that I can't hire engineers for because, you know, somebody thinks of this as a free system. And like that's just the wrong organizational structure, right? That it's nothing wrong with the software. It's wrong with it. There's something wrong with how that was set up. So yeah, in Deno, I'm trying to kind of align the incentives and get the organizational structure in place so that we can build great software.
Cool. That was it.
Great.
Thousands of developers find jobs across Europe using Honeypot. If you're up for a new challenge in one of these European cities, sign up at honeypot.io. If you want to see more tech documentaries, then subscribe so you don't miss the next one.